So we're moving to a more design focused talk today. You can already see HTML5 is going to be a focus. Varun is a software engineer and a blogger, and he's going to be talking about how do you actually do web development today in 2013? How do you use components? How do you use modular development to develop much more quickly than you can? So,
okay. So am I audible at the back? Okay, let's get started. So today I'm going to be talking about the web components and so what we have in future for developing components on the web. So my name is Varun, as Rahul introduced. So this is my Twitter handle, and I actually use Google Plus. You can follow me on as well. Okay. So once upon a time, web was just a platform for creating interactive and navigable contents. So it was just a static contents, and people were using HTML to define static text and images, and so we were using JavaScript to put up some animations or some interactions on that page, and CSS was just used to just show some basic. So it was a presentation layer thing which we were using. The capabilities on the browser were very much limited, and we need to depend on backend servers for accomplishing most of the user tasks. So there are lots of heavy lifting was still done by the backend servers. Things have changed a lot, and so if you look at today's web, so we have this powerful combo of HTML5, CSS3, and JavaScript. Browsers are becoming more and more powerful. So we can do lots of stuff on the, so web applications of today are almost as powerful as the native applications. So we can do lots of stuff on the web platform itself. So we can do, for example, we can build applications which can work offline, so you don't need internet. It'll download all this stuff locally, and you can build applications with that nature. And so your web applications can have access to your camera, and it can access the devices. And we can even have databases and a complete file system on the web platform. So we can even do real-time communication and lots of, so web as a platform has I mean, we have gone so far in the web platform. So with great power actually comes great responsibility. So as a front-end engineer, as web applications are getting complex, as we start putting more and more features in the web applications, so there is a need that we should follow better engineering practices. So back-end engineers have been organizing the complexity, have been modularizing stuff, and so they have been enjoying lots of facilities on the back-end servers. But as a front-end engineer, so it's a need. So we also should start building code that is maintainable. So as a front-end engineer, so we should also start writing code which is maintainable. And to achieve that, the code should be modular, and it should be encapsulated, and so it should be reusable. So basically what it means is we should start building reusable components which anyone can just plug into your page, and so they can use it. So some examples of this reusable components are, so for example, even this Google Plus like button, plus button, and Facebook like button. So all these things are components. So what you take, you take these components and you put it on your page, okay? As I said, backend engineers, so they have been achieving some of these things using the object-oriented language. So any language will inherently support, will help us get there. But how do we get there on the web platform? So before that, so let's see what's actually missing on the web platform today. So let's say, so I'll go back to the same example, the Facebook like button and the Google plus button. So let's say after that, if they are providing some sort of commenting capabilities, okay? So they'll show some text box or some way to actually share your the current page, okay? And so there is a chance that it could lead to some sort of name collision. So whenever you have both these components, you have two components, one from Facebook and one from Google Plus. So there is a very good chance that these guys can collide. And so a comment button within a comment text box within a Facebook component can interact with actually a Google Plus component. So there is no way of DOM. We can't do any sort of DOM encapsulation today. And so that could lead to problems like collision of DOM contents. So it could lead to some same ID collisions and things like that. And it could potentially lead to broken styles. Let's say if Facebook is trying to apply some sort of style for its text box, so that might get applied to Google Plus also. Of course, there are ways of overcoming this. So we use some conventions. So like all Facebook will have some prefix, or we use some suffix or some other conventions to overcome these problems. But inherently, web as a platform doesn't provide any sort of capabilities to overcome these. So that's what we are going to look at today. As web applications get complex, so there is a set of frameworks which are becoming popular. So we call it as MVC frameworks, or in general, we can put it as MV star frameworks. So these help us to some extent. So they'll help us to organize the complexity in our application. So we can separate out the contents and the presentation layer to some extent with if we use any of these MVC frameworks. So we will be able to separate out the contents and the presentation layer. There are so many MVC frameworks available. So I'm not going to get into any of the MV star frameworks, but I'll just talk about how in general any of these frameworks work. For example, if you take any MVC framework, for example, so it will provide you an option to define views. Views are a template. So that is how that's sort of like the presentation layer. And then, so you'll be associating a model with your view. So you'll be creating a model object, and you'll associate that with a view. And then, so we'll have to provide a way for monitoring the changes. So all these libraries provide some sort of mechanism for data binding. So whenever the model object changes, so it should reflect immediately on the views. And whenever the views changes, it should reflect on the model object. So that's the principle with which any of these MVC frameworks work. So let's see how these guys are able to achieve that in today's web. First let's look at how templates are there today. So there are various mechanisms in which you can create a template, but one of the still commonly used method is creating a DOM which is off screen. So you can create a DOM and you can either hide it or you can set its display to none. So this is how we do it. So we generally create a div element or something, so which has it's like an abstraction. It's composed of all its parts, and then so you'll hide it initially, and whenever you want to show it on the screen, so you'll change its visibility. But then it has its own problem. So one of the obvious advantage with this is, so we are working directly on DOM elements. So say it's a declarative, so you don't have to use JavaScript to achieve any of these things. It's declarative. But then some of the obvious problems are, as we create this template, so whatever resources you are trying to load within that page, so those all the resources are preloaded. The moment you create this template, so at that time itself, the images and everything will be loaded. So it doesn't wait for you to actually start consuming that template. So that's one problem. And it doesn't solve any of the problem with encapsulation, which I talked about. Like whenever the same name is being used somewhere else, so it doesn't solve any of those problems. So that's the first method. In the second method, what we do is...
So on the previous slide, you had hidden as a value there, as an attribute.
Yeah.
Is it valid?
Yes.
So it actually works if you simply say hidden in the DOM instead of using CSS?
Yeah.
Okay, that's new. I didn't know about that.
Okay. So the only difference between that and display none is, this will still occupy the space. So it'll occupy, so let's say if your div is of width some 100 pixels, so it'll still occupy that space. So that's the difference between hidden and display none.
So this effectively does the equivalent of visibility colon hidden.
Yes. Okay. And the second method of creating templates today is, so we can either use strings, so whatever the contents which we want to put it up in the template, so we can have a string content, or the other commonly used technique is putting that content within a script tag, I mean, or overloading the behavior of scripts. So you can set some type, something other than JavaScript, so that the browsers doesn't load that. So here the problem is we are sort of getting into parsing this string parsing, and so this could lead to other cross-site scripting attacks and things like that. So this opens up a new set of problems. So we have two methods today. I mean, so we can roughly classify the techniques into these two buckets, but both of these techniques have its own problem. So let's look at, so this is templates of today, and now let's see how models are, what is there in JavaScript space. So in JavaScript, things are a little more better, so we can organize the complexity to a better extent because of its module pattern. So generally, when we create some model or model object or something on JavaScript, so we actually tend to create we use module patterns or JavaScript's object constructor to achieve that. So if you look at any of the implementations of any MVC frameworks like Backbone or something else, so what they do is they'll provide you with one base class for your model. And so you'll have to extend that model to create your model class. So the reason for that is, so whenever you're trying to change any of the property of your model, so they need to know the changes. So inherently, there is no way for you to monitor changes in an object. So I'm talking about present day, today's web. So things are going to change in the future. But in today's web, so there is no easy way for you to monitor for any new property changes of an object. So how these libraries achieve is, so they'll provide you a wrapper object. So you'll be using the accessors of those wrapper object. And so once you use that object, so they'll get to know that you're trying to modify this property. And so that's how it is handled today. This is for the model changes. Now coming for the other side of binding. So for whenever the view changes, how do we map it to the model? So for that, we can use either DOM mutation or some of the event handlers. But so these are not very efficient. So I have a later slide which will talk about what are the better approaches. So in today's web, so even though we are trying to organize the complexity through this MVStar frameworks, so there are some problems which still exist today. So let's see how we can achieve encapsulation today. So this is actually a fundamental concept of object-oriented programming. So this helps us to separate the code which we write from the presentation layer. So in web also we have this to some extent. So we can achieve this with the help of iframes. So iframes help us to abstract stuff to some. So it helps us to make things very secure. But then, so it has its own problem. For example, so it doesn't fit well. So whenever, so it doesn't resize depending on the contents. Let's say if your content is resize to fit the contents. So that's a problem with that. So there is a new spec which is coming up. It's called seamless iframe. So it's actually an attribute which you set on the iframe, which will help to solve some of these problems. It's still very much new. It's not available in all the browsers. So that's something you can watch out for. So what we have seen so far is, we have seen what is the principle behind any MVC framework. So what are all the different components of it? And then, how we are achieving all these things using today's web. So there are lots of problems in these. So whatever stuff which we have discussed, so in today's web, so there are inherent problems in the web platform. So how are we going to solve all this? Web platforms is the solution to all these problems. So it's actually a set of, it's not a single API. So it's a set of API which is going to provide you some of the functionalities. So let's look at all those things. Okay, some of the key players of web components are template. So this is a HTML native way of defining a template. So you can define any inert chunk of clonable DOM, and so you can use it later. So I'll talk about in detail about each of these things. And then also using web components, it will provide you a mechanism to create custom elements. So let's say if you want to extend, so currently there is nothing called, so we have divs, we have spans, paragraphs and stuff like that. But if you want to create a tab container natively in HTML, so currently there is no way for it. So we use some sort of JavaScript library or some library to get there. But so using this custom elements, so you'll be able to create some tab container element, I mean any element for that matter. And so later you'll be able to declaratively use it. And the next one is Shadow DOM. So Shadow DOM is actually the building block of encapsulation that will help you to abstract some of the implementation details to the consumer. So we'll see all these stuff in detail. And some of the supporting things are, so we have something called style encapsulation. So which will help you to specify a style to a particular scope. So we'll see all these things. Okay, we'll start with templates. So as I said, so this is something which is not available in browsers today, but you can expect it. So this spec is, so there is a spec available for this and browser vendors are working on it. So we can soon expect this in different browsers. So how it works is, so we can define, we can use this template element and so we can give an ID for this template and you can define whatever the DOM elements which goes inside that. So again, we are talking about declarative way of defining the component.
A quick question. See, if you say scripts don't run in your template,
yeah,
what happens with browsers that don't understand the template?
So currently,
they'll just render it as inline.
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, that means that you now need a way to also preserve browser compatibility in something that is supposed to be inert.
Yeah.
Okay. Are you covering that? I hope you are.
No, I I'm not covering that, but I'll see. I'll try to see if I can link it to somewhere. So today,
To Jace's point, right? I think the way they will maintain backward compatibility will be exactly like they did for the new HTML5 elements. Is that they'll put div tags inside. We'll have to handle all the backward divs that will hopefully have styles that will hide, and then we'll have to script it to an extent so that we don't end up with things being visible
right. In
old browsers.
Yeah, so you can just put a display none on template and hide it by default in old browsers. But what do you do with scripts? How do you tell the browser to not run scripts?
Display none isn't the only problem. It will still create all the image resources. It'll do a whole bunch of issues will arise when this happens.
So the advantage here is, again, we are directly working on DOM. So it's a declarative way of doing things. And then, so the other advantage is, so the contents are not parsed. And so they're not rendered. So whenever if you have any images or anything within your template, so those things won't get loaded. So this is how you have to use it. So you can just select that template, whatever you have defined. And then, the template.content will give you the document fragment. So whatever you have defined within that template, so you'll get hold of that contents. And you can clone it and attach it anywhere. So wherever you want to use that template, so all you have to do is you just have to clone that content and you just have to include it, append it to the place where you want to insert. Okay. So this solves all the problem which we discussed. So we are not doing any string parsing. So the scripts are not loaded. Of course, there is this backward compatibility issue. But other than that, so it solves all the problems natively on HTML5 itself. Okay. So next, let's see what is Shadow DOM. Shadow DOM is currently available in Chrome Canary. So I'm not sure whether it has landed in Google Chrome, but it is already available in Chrome Canary. I'm using Chrome Canary. So the concept itself is, so it's actually a separate topic in itself. I'm going to cover some of the basics of it and how we can define insertion points in that and different aspects of it. So looks like this is not something new. So some of the DOM elements which we already are aware of, so those are doing that to some extent. So for example, so if you look at any video tag, or if you're looking at any of the special daytime or time input elements. So if you see here, so it's composed of some complex set of controls. So it's not a single control. So you have a slider here, a timeline here, and then so you have the control to pass, play. So these are all different components. But when you actually inspect this thing, so you will so let me go there. So what you are actually seeing here is you have a drop down and there is a spinner. So there is a whole set of complex DOM objects there, DOM elements there. But when you actually look at, when you inspect for that element, so all you are seeing is just a single input. Essentially what browsers are doing is it's hiding some of the DOM nodes within certain other DOM nodes. So this has been there in browsers for some time, but just that it's not exposed to the end users. So Shadow DOM is a specification. It's an API which will help you to, we can also define, we can also hide certain DOM nodes within other DOM nodes. Okay, so this is how it works. So let's say you have the initial DOM component, something like this. So a DOM tree, something like this. You have a host, and you have some certain children. And so let's say if you want to abstract this host node, and if you want to, instead of whatever children it's being rendered, if you want to render this contents, so what you, I'll just jump to the example. So whatever you're seeing on the top, so I'm defining a div element, and so it has a host, and within that I have certain other elements. So it has H1, shows my name and my place, and some other div contents. So that's the original content which is there in the DOM tree. I define a shadow host. So this is how I create it. So currently you have to use the vendor prefix to get there. So what you do is I get the, there is a method called create shadow host. So I actually select the host, and for that host I'm getting the shadow root. So once I get the shadow root, I can add any elements. So here I'm just putting some H2, and I'm just putting some other div contents. So when it's actually rendered on the browser, so instead of seeing the original contents, you'll be seeing the shadow content. So this is a demo actually. Let's see what we are seeing on the, so this is, so is it visible at the back? Okay, I'll just, control on? Yeah, that's what I'm trying to present to you. Okay, I'll just read out what's there. So what you're seeing in the inspector is still the original DOM contents. So it's still showing the ID, div ID host, and within that I'm seeing the H1 element and the H2 which shows the place and things like that. But what it actually rendered is something different. So you have a shadow host, and which has some certain children initially, but you have created a shadow root and you have added some content to that. So when you attach it, it gets replaced. So whatever contents you initially had in your host, so that will be replaced by this new content. This in Chrome developer tools, so there is a way you can actually see what is being rendered. So to do that, there is an option called Show Shadow DOM. So once you enable this option, so instead of the original content, you'll be still able to see the shadow DOM also. Along with that, so you'll be seeing shadow DOM also. So for that, we need to close and open it. So now if I inspect, I think I'll again read out. So now apart from just seeing the original contents of that host, so you're seeing the shadow DOM, whatever contents it got replaced. So that's how it works. So you have to enable the show shadow DOM on your dev tools.
I have a question.
Yeah. Okay.
Is there a way to define the shadow DOM declaratively?
We are declaring, once you get that object, shadow DOM object.
No, rather than doing it in JavaScript, okay. Can I do it in HTML?
So that you can do it in, So if you have custom elements, I'll be talking about that custom elements. So once you define that, so everything you put in within that custom element, it's actually a shadow DOM only. Okay, I'll just quickly run through these things. So now coming to the style encapsulation part. So whatever contents you actually put, so initially we added this H2 and div. So now let's say if I'm adding a style tag within this shadow DOM, so it'll so that style will be applicable only to my shadow DOM. So it's encapsulated within that scope. So I have just setting a H2 color red. So if, as you see, it's only applicable to the inner contents. It's not reflecting on the my host. So to do that, there are properties using which we can change that behavior. Okay, so this is an important point. So we have seen how to set a color. So let's say how to style your DOM, shadow DOM. Okay, so now in practice, what we'll be doing is, so instead of we defining a color or something, so we'll be providing, so when you want to build a theming capability to your shadow DOM, so what we'll be doing is, so that's where CSS variables help in. So we can, so instead of putting the actual color itself, so we can use this var-some variable. So whenever the whoever is consuming this shadow DOM, so they can actually use that variable. So whatever the property they set on that variable, so that will be reflected, that will be used within that shadow DOM. So you can actually use shadow DOM in conjunction with CSS variables. And so the other thing is, so as I showed you, we had some initial contents and we added some shadow DOM. So it entirely got replaced. So instead of that, so there is something called insertion points. So if you don't want the complete contents to be replaced, if you want only certain parts of your original DOM to be used here, so you can use this content element. So you can, so it has a select attribute. So in the select attribute, you can specify any CSS selector. So here what I'm, so this is the original, my host. So in the host, I have something called first name, last name and all. So here, so when I use it, so I can use this content and content select first name. So it will use that CSS selector to select that element from the original host. So this is how it will be used in practice, where so we can specify, so this is more like a way of specifying APIs into your shadow DOM. Now let's look at observers. So we have, so currently what we have is mutation events. So whenever you change a DOM, so whenever you modify a DOM, you add something to your DOM tree, so you'll get notified as events. So I have told in the earlier slide that it's not very efficient. So there is something called, mutation observers. So this is some sort of similar to events, but then so instead of getting notified for each and every event, so whenever a bunch of DOMs are getting modified, you'll get it in a single callback. So there'll be a single callback in which you'll get all the mutations. So then, so it is very efficient when compared to the mutation events. So we'll see that with an example. Okay, so I built a small example today. Team India is taking on Australia. So this is the 15-member squad, and so this is a simple thing which will actually sort and give you the top 11. So initially I'm going to use DOM mutation events. So let's say if I'm clicking on rotate, so it's actually trying to adjust all these 15 players, and it rearranged those players. So in that process, so we have got 2,000 events fired. So we are trying to do some 1,000 rotations, and in that process we have done some DOM manipulations some 2,000 times, and so it has triggered the callback 2,000 times. So now let's see how it will be done in the case of mutation observers. So let's say the same use case, if I use mutation observers, so I'll be getting 2,001 mutations, but I'll be getting all these changes in a one callback. So that's how it is efficient. So also it doesn't do a whole propagation. It doesn't, the event needs, doesn't need, since it's not an event, so it doesn't need to propagate the all way. So you'll get all the mutations in a single callback. So the another interesting thing which is coming up is object observer. This is similar to mutation observer, but it's for objects. So let's say you have a JavaScript object, and if you want to monitor for some changes, so now it's possible. I think it's already available in Chrome Canary. So this is how you have to use it. So you have to use object.observe, and you have to give a observer function, a callback, and so the object which you are actually observing. So whenever you add any new properties or you change some property, so it will get notified. So the, again, the important thing to note here is, so it's not triggered for each and every change. So let's say if you are doing, if you are setting name and if you are setting Twitter handle on a particular object, so the browser, the JavaScript engine decides when to call. So it will club certain operations and it will call the callback in a single go. So now we have seen how to create templates natively, and with the help of Shadow DOM, we'll be able to encapsulate stuff. And so with observers, we'll be able to bind the model and the view. So now that we have got all these things, so how do we create a custom element? So let's say if you want to create something called X tabs, so there is something called element tag. So this is still not available. So what you can do is, so I'll come back to your question. So you were asking so if we can declaratively define a shadow DOM, right? So whatever contents you put in within that template, so that's actually like a shadow DOM. So when you consume it using that X tabs, when you are consuming it, so at that moment you will not be seeing any of the implementation details. Whatever, so for example, so there you are seeing content select H1 first list. So that's an insertion point, and you are declaratively setting it. So once you do that, so when you consume it, so you can declaratively say that H1 title, so it will get replaced there. And so apart from the actual templates and the shadow DOM, you can also put in some scripts. So wherein you can specify some API. So whenever somebody wants to instantiate the component using JavaScript, so they can still do it. So you, so whatever constructor which we specify here, so that will go on global scope. So you can instantiate it from anywhere. So for getting these features, you need to enable. So so these are all the things you have to follow to use some of these features. Okay, so this is a doodle I have built some time back. So this is actually it's not image or it's not, so it's completely CSS and HTML. So there is no images used here. So all these animations are CSS based, and just for the mouse following, so I've used the JavaScript library. So now what I have done is, so I have made this into a component. So there are lots of, okay, again, so today browsers are not supporting any of these, so many of these standards. It supports Shadow DOM and the observers are available, but not all these things which we have discussed are available today, but you can still use it using some of the polyfills. There is one Firefox library called Xtags. And so there is one more polyfill. There is a model view. There is a MDV framework. I think it's from Google. So using some of these things, you can just play with these functionalities today itself. So this is something I have built. And so if you look at the actual DOM, so how I use it is I use the element x-doodle. And so there is a small.
Open Gangnam Style.
So again, if I want to instantiate one more instance of this component, all I have to do is so let's see how we can add it to body. I added a string instead of the element. So it got added.
Open Gangnam.
So now I can anywhere, wherever I want to use this component, I can just use this custom element. So today also you can enable yourself by using some of the polyfills. I'm hoping that all browsers vendors will soon be providing these functionalities, and so that will help us to organize our code better, and so we can natively achieve things which some of the MVC frameworks have been achieving so far. So these are some of the references. That's it from my side. Any questions?
What is the performance impact of these components?
Like, as opposed
I mean,
to...
I haven't really done anything. I haven't actually looked into the performance aspect of it. So this is very new actually. So not all browsers are supporting it. So only Shadow DOM and style encapsulation features are available on that to Chrome Canary alone. And so there is one more. There is an excellent library from Firefox. It's called Xtax. So you can use that to use some of these standards. But I haven't really done any performance analysis on that.
Hi. Is there any limitation of the code what we are using? Because here it seems like we have to encapsulate the JavaScript, HTML, and CSS all together. So
okay.
Is that limited to one single file or something? You know.
So there is nothing like that. It all mandates is you need to follow that structure. But how you include that, it can be spread across multiple files or so there is no mandate on how you organize your source code. So all it needs is, so it specifies certain format. You need to create a custom element tag. And within that, you can put your Shadow DOM. And so that's all it mandates. But it doesn't mandate you to keep it in a single file or you can keep it in a different file also.
Okay, so basically it is it's the same as like how we are currently doing, like first when you're loading a page, you have to load all the supportive files and everything, but
yeah.
The way of creation of the DOM or creation of the object will be the different.
Yeah, exactly. So if I want to, so let's say if so we have this component. So let's say if somebody else want to consume it, so I'll be providing a single file. And so all the other guy needs to do is, so he needs to include that as a link relative components. And so once that is done, so he'll be able to. This is how the consumer needs to use it. He needs to add a link tag with the HTML. So this is where the original definition of the custom element was there. And so once you have that, so all you need is just that the definition. So after that, you can start consuming it. Any other questions? So there is a very good Google Plus page where lots of talks and information about the specification are posted. So you can follow that, or you can follow Eric Biedelmann. So actually, this presentation itself was inspired by his talk. There is a very nice article about Shadow DOM on HTML5 rocks. It's called Shadow DOM 101. So this article talks about the basics of Shadow DOM. And these things are about mutation observers. And
Do you see people using this instead of templating as we do it right now?
I haven't seen anybody using it in production, or it's not even close to that. But I mean, as the spec gets more standardized and as more browser vendors start using it, so probably this will be the future.
All right. So you know, it seems like a very neat way of essentially taking a single replicating component that's often repeated,
yeah,
and inserting it in multiple places without,
yeah,
changing the code.
Yeah.
Now, when you do that, can you make each of them slightly different in their behavior?
Yes, so that's what we have this APIs for. So apart from declaratively defining your the actual component, so you can even write some JavaScript. So that'll help you to change the behavior. So let's say
It's 16 hours.
Sorry, it's a same tab controller component, but now I am adding a constructor to it, and I can define certain methods within here. So when you instantiate that tab controller, you can actually set certain attribute or certain things, and you can change the behavior.
Okay, so you can actually run a script,
yes,
custom every time you reuse,
yeah,
a component. Okay,
yeah.
And did I just notice a style tag in the section there in the previous slide, the slide you were at just now? So you got a style tag there now, which is not in the head. Yeah.
I define an element. So this is the whole HTML will contain only this element declaration, and within that I'll put up a style. So this style will be scoped only to this element.
Right.
So but that's the style encapsulation. So if I want to, what exactly?
No, does it inherit the parent?
It doesn't. It doesn't. So that's what I was saying. So if you want to override that behavior, so there is something called reset style inheritance. Or let me go back to that slide. Yeah, it's called reset style inheritance. So okay. By default, any style which you put in within a DOM, shadow DOM, it doesn't inherit anything from the parent. And okay. Also, whenever you put some, whatever styles you put in here, so that doesn't go back to the consumer.
Right.
So if you want to overwrite that behavior, so there are two properties, reset style inheritance and apply author style. So okay. Once you, so the first one indicates that, so if you set it to true, it will inherit the styles from the container page. And the second one, what it says is the other direction. So if you set it to true, by default, it's false. So let's say here I have changed H2. And this is this style encapsulation title, that is also H2. Currently, that's not getting reflected, even though I have set the content. So I'll show you the. OK, so this is how I'm doing. Because Shadow DOM is something already available. This default behavior is only scoped. It's limited to that Shadow DOM. So even though I have set this H2, so it's getting applied only to this. So this is the Shadow DOM which is rendered. And it's getting applied only to this guy, and not to something else which I have on the page. So for example, so this is the title of the page, so which again is a H2 element, but it's not getting reflected. I think I can show you. Okay, it doesn't support live editing.
That's pretty cool, thanks.
Thanks.
Hi Varun, one more question.
Okay.
Here.
Yeah.
So that style tag, right? I believe it was inline there, but can it be external call as well?
Yes, it can be external as well.
So you said that it doesn't parse it, right? When on page load, that template.
Yeah.
So does it get downloaded on page load, or does it get downloaded when it's in it?
I'll have to check. I'll check and get back to you on that actually.
Okay.
Guys, so we're going to take another break now. For those who still have questions, Varun's going to be around. Otherwise, we'll see you at 4:15.